Well, good morning on this fine day. Whoever you are, wherever you find yourself on life's journey, whenever it is you're joining us for this time of worship on whatever screen you're using, you're welcome to be part of this time of remembering our good God. This season of isolation continues. We're learning new habits and rhythms. We are missing our old habits and rhythms. We are figuring out what it means to work at home, or as some have called it, living at work. We are trying to figure out schooling. And meanwhile, all kinds of other news keeps piling on. Natural disasters, other diseases, unrest of various kinds. It's a lot to deal with. And overload is common. These times can make us anxious. They can even make us fearful. And so worship in times like this is essential as we pause in our schedule to remember what we believe to be true and necessary, to give thanks, to encourage one another in what we know to be true and good, namely, that God is, that God knows, that God loves. A couple thousand years ago, a prophet named Zechariah was writing to people who were returning from a long time away from their home, away from their routine. And in the course of his teaching of them and repeating for them words from God, he said this, and it's recorded in the 9th chapter of the book that bears his name. Return to your fortress, you prisoners of hope. That word fortress is one that Zechariah pulled out of the Psalms, which speak about God as a stronghold on a number of occasions. Return to your fortress. Come into where God is, Zechariah is saying. You prisoners of hope. And these people knew what it meant to be prisoners, to be captive against their will, to be held by forces that were not interested in them. And yet now Zechariah is turning that idea around to say, you're prisoners no longer of oppressive forces, but rather of one who is good. You're a prisoner of hope. Hope is what holds you now. You can root yourselves in this. And we can too, thousands of years later. We can hold on to God. We can stand firm in God. That's what worship invites of us. That's what worship is designed to encourage. So as we come into this season of worship, let's pause. Let's be here. Let's look to the Lord for what we need to bring our thanks and praise, to ground ourselves again in this one who is good and great. Please pray with me. Loving God, thank you for this day that you have made. Thank you for the lives that you sustain. God, thank you for what is true. Thank you for what doesn't change. As we spend these moments together in worship, God, would you please guide us? Would you please help us to sense your presence in ways that make sense to each of us? Draw us close to you, we pray. Bless our time together, we ask. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Our call to worship comes from Psalm 103. Praise the Lord, O my soul.
O my inmost being, praise God's holy name.
Praise the Lord, O my soul.
And forget not all God's blessings.
In our confession, we approach the Lord with contrite hearts. We also do this with a confidence that God loves us and hears us well. And so let us pray. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him and he will make your paths straight. Amen. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all God's blessings. God forgives all your sins. God heals all your diseases. God redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion.
I
never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails, never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love. In death, in life, I'm confident and covered by the power of your great love. My debt is paid, there's nothing that can separate my heart from your great love. My debt is paid, I'm confident and covered by the power of your great love. My debt is paid, there's nothing that can separate my heart from your great love. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out. Never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails, never gives up, never runs out on me.
Our scripture this morning is Psalm 103, and you'll find that inside the program. If you downloaded it, if you have a Bible with you, you can open up and follow along. We have several readers who will be sharing this psalm with us remotely.
Today's reading is from Psalm 103, verses 6 to 12. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. And as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us.
Good morning. I'm going to be reading the 103rd Psalm, verses 13 through 18. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. The life of mortals is like grass. They flourish like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it, and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep his covenant and remembers to obey his precepts.
Psalm 10, 3, 19, 22. The Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. Praise the Lord, you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding. Who obey this word. Praise the Lord, all his heavenly hosts, you his seven servants who do this will. Praise the Lord, all his works ever in his dominion. Praise the Lord, my soul.
So what we've heard from these readers, this is the word of God for the people of God. And Lord, as we go into your word now, we thank you for it. We thank you that it's available. We thank you that it's accessible. And we pray that you would be speaking to us by your Holy Spirit in ways we can understand, so that our lives might more and more take on the character and the quality that you desire for us. Amen. When it comes to God, there are a few things we want to be mindful of. For instance, it's possible to treat God like the pine cone wreath that your grandmother made. It's beautiful, it evokes good memories, but it only comes out on certain days. The rest of the time, it's carefully tucked away, out of sight and out of mind. It's possible to treat God like Play-Doh, a substance that we have in front of us to fashion into whatever we like or need. Going through a difficult time, then we expect God to make it go away, or God is supposed to pull us out. Is there a job interview or a test? Well, God is supposed to intervene, to step in and give the kinds of results I expect. It's possible to treat God like Neptune, something we've heard of existing, a planet that is far away. We are willing to believe it's there, but it is so distant as to have little bearing on our lives. The Psalms help us with all three of these. They insist on a God who is here now, a God who is with us, a God who is interested in our situation, a God who supplies what we need for a meaningful life. This God is one to whom we can pour out our hearts. This God is faithful in expressing love, kind, and careful as we move through our days. God is deeply good. The Psalms also insist that God is awesome and great, that God is the maker, that God is the sustainer, that God is immeasurable and unassailable. God is steady and strong. The Psalms give us these pictures of God. They offer praise to God. They show us many who bring their pleas to God. The Psalms help us to appreciate God, to worship God, to grow deeper in our relationship with God. And Psalm 103 is a good example of so much of this, and so it's a fitting place to conclude our summer study of the Psalms. And I invite you now to walk through it with me as we listen to David begin on a note of praise. Praise the Lord, my soul, all my inmost being, praise his holy name. You feel like this is a normal gear for David, that he finds ways to praise God on a regular basis, but even still, from time to time, he wants to speak to himself specifically and says, here's what we're going to do. We're going to lift God up in praise. All of me is going to engage in this as we praise God's holy name. He repeats himself in the second verse, praise the Lord, my soul, and don't forget his benefits. Don't forget the blessings that God pours out. And there follows now a list of the blessings that pour from a generous hand. God forgives all your sins. God heals all your diseases. The forgiveness and the healing that God offers is meant to bring wholeness and health to bodies that have been fractured and splintered and disintegrated. God steps in. God redeems your life from the pit. We were captive. We were unable to help ourselves. God steps in and does what's necessary, does what we were incapable of doing, makes it possible for our lives to continue outside of this pit that David identifies. Verse 5, God satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. David's not promising here a fountain of youth that if you come to God, you'll never get old. David would know, like the rest of us who are advancing in years, that your energy does diminish. You do lose a step on the court. But it's still possible that our enthusiasm for life in God's company stays fresh. And that's what he's referring to here. In verse 6, David knows that the Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. Remember, David served as king for a number of years. It was his job to do what was right. It was his job to pursue what was just. And he's remembering that behind him and in front of him is God who does this, God who he needs to imitate. This pursuit of justice, this commitment to righteousness. David learns this from following God's example. In verse 8, the Lord is compassionate and gracious. It's a phrase that's used to describe God in a variety of places. When Jonah is finally in Nineveh after his various adventures, and he walks around the city and explains to the people what God is up to and what God is after, they all hear him and they say, "We need to change." And so they repent, every last one of them, the text says. And Jonah, meanwhile, has gone out of the city and climbed a hill to watch the destruction he knows is coming, the destruction he wants to come, the destruction that's the only right outcome for a people like this. And yet God doesn't do that. God forgives them. And Jonah is there on this hill, shaking his fist at God, saying, "I knew you were like this. I knew that you were compassionate. I knew that you were gracious." It's an awkward moment. Jonah being so angry at God for being consistent with God's own nature. You're compassionate and you're gracious. And sometimes we find ourselves in a place where we'd rather not be either. David, no doubt, had those kinds of experiences as well, but he remembers that God is gracious and compassionate, and he wants for that to sink into his own life. If this is how God is, if this is how God is towards me, then perhaps I can be this way as I interact with others as well. Verse 11, as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is God's love for those who fear him. You get the sense of the scope that David's working with. He thinks about God's love, and there's really no limit to the extent and the expression of God's love. In verse 17, he moves from geography to chronology, from everlasting to everlasting. The Lord's love is with those who fear him. Not only is this love expansive in its scope, it's extensive in its and how long it lasts. There's no end to this love. Now, if we become convinced that we are loved like that we are loved by someone who's truly wonderful, loved in all these dimensions, what effect might that have on our attitudes, on the decisions that we make? Verse 19, the Lord has established his throne in heaven. His kingdom rules over all. We've been hearing this in the Psalms that we've read about the Lord's throne and how there is no question regarding God's supremacy, no threats to God's sovereignty. What God has established will endure. God reigns forever. David himself, as king, knows that his kingdom, even if it lasts a couple of decades, is going to come to an end. God's rule will not. There's a consistency there. There's a dependability. And then verse 20. David draws the psalm to a close in the same way that he opened it, on this note of praise. Praise the Lord, you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding. Praise the Lord, all his heavenly hosts, his servants who do his will. He starts in the heavens and says, all you there, these beings of various kinds described for us in different places in the scripture, David calls them to praise, and we know from the glimpses that we have of these heavenlies that that is so often what they are engaged in, that they are praising the Lord. The book of Revelation, for instance, gives us examples of this time and again of these beings around the throne singing their praises, offering glory to God. David wants to put himself in their number and calls them to account for praise. Verse 22, it's not just the heavenlies. Praise the Lord, all his works everywhere in his dominion. Psalm 19 speaks about the rocks and hills and the stars and moon and sun and how they praise God. All the works everywhere in his dominion. It's not just the nature around us, it's also the people that God has made, the people to whom God gives life. These David calls into praise as well. All of you, all of us. May praise flow from us. And then the last phrase, it's where he began. Praise the Lord, my soul. It's not just something I'm asking of others. It's not just something I'm expecting from outside and elsewhere. He says, this is me too. This is where I want to be. This is who I want to be. One who praises the Lord. David lives aware of God, in awe of God, walking along the path each day brings with God. And David's experience is one we can share as well. May we be people like this, who recognize that God is with us in all that we encounter and experience. This great one, who is not made by us, not fashioned according to our whim or desire. This God who is close, not distant, but near. Next week, we're going to be moving back into the lectionary readings that will have us moving back and forth between Paul's letter to the Philippians and Matthew's gospel account of Jesus' life and ministry. And I would encourage you to be picking up these books and taking a closer look at them as we spend some time with them over the coming weeks and months. But as you're doing that, you might also look for ways to weave the Psalms into your reading and into your thinking and into your praying. You can get through the entire collection of the Psalms by reading probably about 3 pages in your Bible each day. That'll take you through the Psalms in a month. And you could do that a couple times a year and start to hear these words and phrases and ideas to find them sinking into your heart, shaping the perspective that you have, the praise that you offer as you move through whatever it is you're encountering in these days, knowing that you're not alone. Knowing that the God who is near is great, is good, who is with us, each one. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for a psalm like this one that reminds us of who you are and what you're like. We hear so many voices around us that want to tell us what God is like or what God isn't like. And so to have a voice like David's is so helpful. To hear this one speaking out of experience and to notice the ways that his experience resonates with ours. God, keep teaching us about yourself and about who we are in relationship to you. Keep filling our hearts and our minds, we pray. As we move through our days, may it be to the praise of your glory. Amen. And this good, good God calls us to come before him with our requests, with our thanks. We're going to spend these next moments praying with and for one another. I encourage you to join with me in this, to lift what's in your heart before the Lord, whether it's a person or a situation, something you're going through, something you know somebody else is facing. Let's pray together, confident that the Lord hears us and speaks into these areas of need. Loving and gracious God, praise be to your holy name. Thank you for the rich privilege of coming before you in prayer, and we lift many voices to this. We thank you, God, that you are at work in the world around us, that this is of interest to you, and so we pray for those that have responsibilities and governing people and crafting laws and holding people accountable to them. Lord, we pray that there would be a growing desire, a deep commitment to pursuing what is righteous, what is just, what leads to peace. We pray for your church. And we know, God, that you have groups of your people all over this world, people in whom you are at work, people through whom your spirit can be evident. And God, we pray that your people might bring into the situations they encounter grace and love and compassion. And they would be motivated by what encourages peace, that they would give freely and gladly. We pray for this church. Lord, as we continue to find ways of encouraging one another, as we seek wisdom for how you would have us to use the resources with which you've entrusted us, guide us, we pray. We pray for the people we know. We thank you for the rich privilege of relationships with so many, family members and friends, people where we work, people at school, those in our neighborhoods and in our orbits. And God, as we're aware of the needs these people have, we lift them before you and pray for your good work to bring healing and wisdom and strength, to bring courage and clarity. God, we pray for the Reiner family with the passing of Betty this week. We pray for the Farling family and for the Tumas family as well in their times of recent loss. We pray for Isabel and for Beth Ann. We remember Brandon. Pray for Millie, for Jim and for Sharon, for Kathy, for Joan, for Rachel, for Jim, for Betty and Gail and Lynn. And we pray for ourselves in these days when it's so easy to get distracted, to succumb to the temptation of anxiety and fear and anger, that God, we would draw on the strength that you provide, that you would meet us where we are and bring us what we need to live lives that honor you, that bless those around us. Thanks, Lord, that you hear us. Help us to keep trusting you, we pray, as we lift all of this to you, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We see evidence of God's goodness in the way that God provides for us. And when we bring offerings, one of the things we're doing is to express our gratitude for God's careful and generous kindness. You can send offerings in through the mail. We have an online platform as well. And pretty soon we're going to have an in-person way of collecting offerings. We'll talk more about that in the coming days. But as we are considering the resources that God gives us, let us be generous and courageous people in using those for God's glory.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Lord, as we think of all the ways that you've blessed our lives, all the benefits that you shower upon us, we are grateful indeed. As these offerings come, may they be used in ways that extend the kingdom, that benefit those in need. We thank you for these opportunities. We praise you for your generous provision on all of it. In the name of our Lord and Savior. Amen. Your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness. Your goodness is running after, it's running after.
I will sing of the goodness of God. Sing that chorus with me one more time. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain from beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you can lift me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me. Hallelujah.
God is good. Amen? Amen? Amen. Well, for the past 6 months, we have been learning how to have services like this in a setting that is different from what we're accustomed to. We have had people coming every week to help us with that, Musicians Betsy and Mike have been backstopping this whole operation with their music, and others have been here faithfully singing and playing. We have technicians who are showing up every week to make sure that this gets out and we can have recordings available through the week. We have people writing checks for the equipment that we're using. We have people crawling under this building to run the wires so that it all connects. We have people taking care of the outside of this place so that it stays looking great. And there have been many hands engaged in the work of these services and the other aspects connected with life here at St. Thomas over these months. Next week, we move into a new phase as we open the building for worship in the sanctuary and in Fellowship Hall. Now, we are not going back to the way it was. We are moving ahead into something new. But we've been doing that for a while, and we figured that out, and it's going to take us a while to get this new phase figured out as well. So as we move into this new phase, let me encourage you to keep praying, to keep supporting, to keep helping. We're going to continue to need help in offering these services and other parts of church life. So there's plenty of room for people to use the gifts that God has given as we worship together, as we serve together, as we encourage one another. You'll be getting some more information about what our schedule's like starting next week. Right now, the plan is to have the traditional service here in the sanctuary at 8:15. Our casual service over in Fellowship Hall at 10:30. We're working on some overflow spaces because in each of these rooms, the seating capacity is limited. Our effort is to care for one another and those around us. And so we are going to continue adhering to the guidelines that we're being given by those that are looking at this virus carefully. At the same time, we'll be able to gather at least some of us for worship in person, and that'll be a good experience. We plan to keep offering online worship as well, and so we'll be live streaming these services at 8:15 and 10:30, and we'll have recordings of those available on the YouTube channel. So, next phase, next week, more information to come. Between now and then, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and keep you in peace as you hear news, as you encounter people, as you find yourself tempted to be fearful or anxious. May you remember that you are a prisoner of hope, held by a God who is, a God who knows, a God who loves you, a God who is with you every step of the way. Amen.